wouldn't want to be a Muppet Baby?
No.
I think I'd thrive as a Muppet Baby.
What would you do?
Well, do you know what Muppet Babies do?
Not really.
Well, they make their dreams come true.
Oh, okay.
And Muppet Babies, they'll do the same for you. So who wouldn't want their dreams to come true?
Oh, true. Yeah.
All they do, Muppet Babies, they just play, but they would play like usually movies.
Oh.
So they're like, hey, what if we were in Star Wars? And then they just play Star Wars for a while.
Oh, see, that's
but their imaginations
perfect for
are
you.
So great that yeah. you can actually see it all. And they get dropped into like real movies.
Mm-hmm.
So they'd have a scene from Indiana Jones or whatever, and it's Kermit, like animated Kermit, running through it.
Oh.
That would be so much fun.
Yeah, you'd thrive in that.
Because when the world looks kind of weird and you wish that you weren't there, just close your eyes and make believe, and you could be anywhere.
Uh-huh.
They are frustrated with the world around them. It's unsatisfying, so they make their own world.
Yeah.
Muppet Baby World.
Wow. Let's do that.
Oh, man, I love Muppet Babies. It's such a good theme song, too. But we're not talking about the no. Muppet Babies theme song. We're talking about all sorts of other music.
Yes.
Well, one sort.
One music.
Johnny Cash.
Yeah.
So welcome, everyone, to another episode of I Love This, You Should Too. My name is Indy Kermy Randhawa. And with me is my lovely co-host. Well, if I say Samantha Piggy
yeah,
Randhawa.
Yeah, it doesn't sound great.
Samantha, Miss Samantha Randhawa. You take the miss more than the piggy part.
I think so.
Yeah.
What are we going to do today?
We're talking all Johnny Cash. So two episodes ago, you had your big Taylor Swift, I was going to say album. And then I was going to correct myself because you don't use the word album. You use the word era.
That's
and then
album.
I was going to correct myself because you that's not what it was. It was you talking all about the concert, and we had a whole episode about it. And
yeah.
Go listen to that if you prefer Taylor Swift to Johnny Cash. But if you prefer Johnny Cash, or if you prefer biographies, mm-hmm. today is the episode for you. Because I am going to be talking all about him, and we're going to do a full kind of biography.
Yeah,
I'm going to tell you his life story, because I think he led a pretty remarkable life. We're going to listen to music along the way.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's a Johnny Cash day today.
Awesome.
We haven't done this in a while. We did it for Bob Marley. A few years ago.
Yeah.
And I think we will rebroadcast that episode next. So if
awesome.
You like that, if you like this one, you'll like that one too.
Yeah.
So before we get into it, I will be playing videos for Samantha. And of course, you at home can't see because we are not a video podcast, because is that still a podcast? I guess.
Yeah.
I don't know.
There's most podcasts now are video podcasts and then also release the audio.
I don't love that. But what you can do, I will give you all a link to a Google Slides presentation and you can like PowerPoint along with us. If you
Excellent.
Really want to nerd out,
oh, yeah.
you can follow along. It's in the show notes. Go click on that.
I love a PowerPoint.
But for the audio portion, every now and then I might not use mm-hmm. the video's audio. I might just throw in the studio version of that song if the video's audio isn't great.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll be one of those two, but it'll still be the same song.
Awesome.
Before we get started, I want to know from you, what do you know about Johnny Cash, or what do you think? Any preconceptions?
He's a singer.
Mm-hmm.
He sang about a prison.
He did sing about a prison, yeah.
He's married to June Carter Cash.
Correct.
Yeah. And I liked the movie.
Oh, because you've seen Walk the
yeah.
Line. Okay, so you know a good
yeah,
bit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Not like a lot, because it's been many years since I've seen it. So.
And that movie is pretty much about the relationship
yeah.
between June and Johnny. That's really it. There is some of outside of that biography, but it's mostly concentrated
mm-hmm.
on that. Which is like, it's a pretty remarkable love story as
mm-hmm.
well.
Yeah, it seemed very tumultuous and dramatic.
Well, let's get into it. And we are going to start way back. On February 26, 1932,
Ooh.
When J.R. Cash was born in Kingsland, Arkansas. And he was the fourth of seven children. Big family.
Wow.
Big farming family. At birth, he was named J.R. Cash. And then it wasn't until he enlisted in the U.S. Air Force, and we'll get to that too, they asked, like, oh, what's JR stand for? And he just said, nothing. It's just JR. Because it didn't stand for anything. Yeah. His name was JR. That was it. So he created the name John on the spot and said, like, and then that became his name.
Oh, that's interesting.
That's not even his name. When he was three, they moved to Dias, Arkansas, one of those New Deal colonies, to establish for poor families to give them a chance to work the land. Of course, that land was, you know, stolen.
Yeah.
But he didn't steal it. And as we'll find out, he was a friend to the indigenous American.
Oh.
We'll get to that. And he started working in the cotton fields as young as 5 years old and started singing along with his family while working. That was his first kind of introduction to music. And his family's and his own struggles through the Great Depression would go on to influence a lot of his music over the years.
Hmm.
And here is the first known picture of Johnny Cash. Oh. Little baby Johnny.
Yeah.
Baby JR.
That was a popular haircut back then.
Just cut.
Cut.
And he was really close to his older brother, Jack. But in 1944, Jack was pulled into a table saw and essentially cut in half.
Oh, my God.
And he was only 15 years old.
Oh, my God. That's horrific.
So Johnny often spoke about, like, the guilt that he felt over this incident and this thing that happened to him at such a young age, because he was... like 12-ish, right around there at the time. It changed his life and was kind of one of the biggest influences on his life, because his mother had told him and his brother to, like, skip work for a day, like, take a day off, take a rest, go fishing. And Jack insisted on working because the family needed the money, and that was the day that the accident happened.
Aww.
And on his deathbed, Jack said that he saw heaven and he saw angels, and Johnny Cash would remain a very devout spiritual man until his death, largely because of this.
Wow.
So he always talked about that he doesn't fear death because he looks forward to meeting his brother in heaven, and he truly believed that. He was taught guitar by his mother and a childhood friend and began writing and playing his own songs as early as 12. And in high school, he was able to sing on the local radio station. Mm. And if you're a farm kid from Arkansas, that's making it big.
Big deal, yeah.
So then he went on to enlist in the U.S. Air Force in 1950, and that is where he came up with the name John. Real creative one.
I think it's funny that his brother had a name, but he just had letters.
Letters can be a name. That's kind of cool. I like that. Like, what if my name was just M? Just the letter M? It'd be slick. That's a good letter, too.
Yeah, I guess.
I couldn't use I because I already means I.
Something, yeah.
Yeah. And when he was in the Air Force, he was stationed in San Antonio and met a woman named Vivian Liberto at a roller skating rink.
Ooh.
And you probably never heard of her.
No.
No, that is Johnny Cash's wife.
Oh.
We don't talk about her all that much for reasons that will become clear, because he was not a great husband.
Yeah, I bet.
So they dated for 3 weeks until he was deployed to Germany, and he was part of the 12th Radio Squadron Mobile Unit.
Whoa.
Of the U.S. Air Force. So that meant that rather than flying planes, he was monitoring radios. That's what he did in the wars. And he was stationed in Landsberg, Germany, and was a Morse code operator and was in charge of intercepting Soviet Army transmissions.
Oh.
And it's there that he created his first band. They were called the Landsberg Barbarians. And he was honorably discharged in 1954 and then returned to Texas. And not very long after, about a month later, he ended up marrying Vivian Liberto in San Antonio. And they had four daughters. So Roseanne, who a lot of people have heard of, Roseanne Cash, is not June's daughter. This is from his first marriage.
Oh, see, I didn't know that.
Yeah, but it was Roseanne, Kathy, Cindy, and Tara. And in 1961, they moved to California, and there they kind of like ran a small trailer park. I think that's what they were doing for a while. And he was drinking a lot, and he was getting into trouble, and she would file for divorce in 66 because of his drug and alcohol abuse, and his probably constant affairs, and his relationship with June Carter. And we will get to all of those points, but spoiler, they don't stay together, Vivian and him.
Yeah.
So now we're going back to 1954, and they moved to Memphis, Tennessee, not for the great music scene. He was selling appliances.
Oh.
And at night, he would play with his band, the Tennessee Two, who I think then, after a while, became the Tennessee Three. But he...
Was there only two of them?
The Tennessee Two? Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry, when I hear band, I think of more than two people, so...
Well, it's Johnny Cash and the Tennessee Two.
Oh, so it's three.
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, I guess when there's, if you're the Tennessee Two, you could have just said it's Johnny Cash and Steve and Doug. You could just use their names.
Yeah, I don't know why. I think of like five people when I think band.
Sure. Well, the White Stripes, my favorite band.
How many are they?
Two.
Oh, okay. Maybe I'm wrong then. Maybe I need to adjust my thinking of what a band is.
In fact, I found out about the White Stripes in the late 90s from this compilation album called It Takes Two that was all two-piece bands.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, who needs a bass?
Yeah.
Not Jack. But we're not talking about that. That'll be on a later episode. So he eventually goes and he visits a Sun Records studio. And Sun Records was like a big time. They had like Elvis and stuff, right?
Yeah.
So they were known. And he wanted to get a recording contract. And I believe there's a good scene of this in that movie,
uh-huh.
Walk the Line, where he is unsuccessful with his religious music because he plays a lot of gospel. So
right.
He does that and they're like, nah, what else you got? And then he starts bringing into what we would now call like early rockabilly.
Mm-hmm.
And in 1955, he made his first recordings at Sun, which were Hey Porter and Cry, Cry, Cry,
uh-huh.
which are still some of his best known works, I think. And then his career starts taking off in the late 50s, and he starts drinking a lot, and he becomes addicted to amphetamines and barbiturates. And for a brief time, he shared an apartment in Nashville with Waylon Jennings.
Oh, wow.
So before they were big time, they were buddies.
Roommates.
And Waylon Jennings was not just a good contact in the world of country music. He was a good contact in the world of being addicted to amphetamines.
Oh.
Because he was on them, so... Johnny sure was too, and he would take a lot to stay awake during those long tours. And we are going to look at him playing Big River. The video we have here is from 1961, so let's go Big River, one of his earlier recordings.
Now I taught the weeping willow how to cry, and I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky. And the tears that I cried for that woman are gonna flood you, Big River. And I'm gonna sit right here until I die. I met her accidentally in St. Paul, Minnesota. And it tore me up every time I heard her drawl, southern drawl. Then I heard my dream went back downstream, cavorting in Davenport. And I followed you, Big River, when you call.
Well, that sounded like what I think of as like classic Johnny Cash.
Yeah,
yeah.
And it was. That was one of his first big hits. And then his next record, Folsom Prison Blues, made the country top five chart. And the hits of that one, of course, were Walk the Line, which that's probably one that you're familiar
yes,
with.
Yeah.
And that became a number one on the country charts and even entered the pop charts and made the top 20 there.
Oh.
In 1958, he left Sun to sign with Columbia because they were offering him some big money.
Mm-hmm.
And his single, Don't Take Your Guns to Town, became one of his biggest hits with them. So he moved on to Columbia and started releasing some more gospel music at
uh-huh.
that time. But because he had recorded so much with Sun, they would keep releasing his music for many years afterwards. And many years afterwards, period.
I guess this was the time before artists really owned their own work.
Yeah, because you didn't own any studio, right?
No. So you just like recorded and then the record company was like, this is ours now. And like whether or not you want to be with us anymore.
And you are coming at it from a Taylor Swift perspective.
I am.
The majority of the world, that's how it works.
I know. But I just think about the fact that like he went to a different record label and was doing something different. And they were still releasing his old stuff.
Yeah, there's so many crazy stories about that. Like, that's why Prince became the artist formerly known as Prince, because he wasn't allowed to record albums anymore because he had a contract. So he said, ah, well, I am not Prince, I am the symbol. And that's how he got away with it. There's so many stories of, like, if there's artists that have, like, one terrible album, oftentimes it was very intentional that they had a contract that they had to fulfill. So they just put out a bunch of garbage and
so that it didn't sell. And and then they could move on. Yeah, that's interesting. But back to Johnny Cash.
Yeah, let's go on and let's watch here, or listen for you. Let's go to one of the big hits and I Walk the Line.
Oh, yeah.
And the video I have, if you get a chance to watch it, it's the earliest video of Johnny that I could find.
Okay.
So he looks so young in this one. It's great.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day's through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
Doesn't he look so young in that
one? So young. He still sounds like Johnny Cash, though, so he definitely had that sound the whole time.
I like that video because he looks so young.
Yeah.
Second, he looks scared.
He does. He's
a pretty confident guy, but this was so early on that he was not in that one. He only has two guys behind him, still the Tennessee Two. Uh-huh. That third guy hasn't joined yet. And they're using an upright bass as percussion, essentially.
Which is, like, really interesting.
Country music didn't have drums
then.
And also, he's wearing all white.
Yeah.
Which you know him as.
The Man in Black.
The Man in Black. Yeah. And we'll get to that too.
Okay.
So now we're going to jump into the early 60s. And Johnny is touring with the Carter family. So the Carter family is kind of like country music royalty at this time.
Of course.
It's Mother Maybelle. It's the daughters Anita, June, and Helen. And he had first met June in 1955 and became, like, quite infatuated with her at a very young age before there was, like, anything to it. He just saw her and was like, that's the woman I'm going to marry.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, which is weird.
It's kind of weird,
It can be creepy if they're not into it, but if they are, it's the most romantic thing ever.
Yes,
it's
a weird thing. Yeah, that's the line.
Yeah, he walks that line.
Yeah, of, like, if she doesn't actually like you, it's stalking.
Yeah. Yeah. From what I hear, he didn't actually stalk her as much as they toured together and he was quietly pining.
Yeah.
So he's addicted to painkillers at this point, amphetamines at this point.
Right.
And but he continues to be successful. And then he has his version of the song Ring of Fire, which is maybe his most popular song ever. Maybe his most well-known.
I think so,
It's definitely in the top three. And this one is like a real crossover hit because it's number one on the country charts and makes the top 20 of the pop charts. And it's a really interesting song in a lot of ways in the history of him and country music, because this was a song that was actually written by June Carter. And it's written about Johnny Cash.
Oh.
Yeah, so it was originally performed by her sister, and then he was like, oh, this song's like, this is good. I can do something with it. So he ends up doing a version of it. So Ring of Fire is a cover.
Yeah.
Johnny wasn't the original on that one.
Huh.
So I think it's just awesome because it's about him and he's singing it now. But the most influential thing, maybe not influential, the most revolutionary thing about that song is the horns.
Mm.
Like, we saw that country music is guitar and a bass.
Yeah.
End of list.
And that's it. Yeah.
And then some people have, depending on what kind of stuff you're doing, you have a fiddle, you might have some percussion, you might have a washboard, all sorts of other stuff.
Oh yeah, I forgot about washboards as a thing.
But one thing they did not have are mariachi style horns. And that arrangement was actually something that Johnny created. So he was, you don't often think of him as like, oh, a great musician.
Right.
But he was like a really talented musician too. He had a brain for that. And the horns received a lot of criticism because racism, right. Essentially. So this is going to be a theme that happens a lot and is something that still happens now. Country music is one of the most, it was probably the most gatekeepy of music, mm-hmm. because of the Country Music Association.
Oh, yeah.
They determine this is country, this is not country. Right. You cannot just go make country music. They'll say, like, no, that doesn't count.
Oh.
And it's not often, we'll find, as we'll see, it's not often just because of how it sounds, but the content and who is making it.
Oh.
Because in recent years, I think we've seen that with, what's that dude, Lil Nas X?
Yes.
Remember, he had that song. And it was going up the country charts. So then the Country Music Association said, that is not country music. And it was off the charts just like that. Because wow. It can't be on a country chart if it's not country.
Not country music.
You can't win a country music award if you're not country.
Right.
So that's why Billy Ray Cyrus is on like a version of it.
Right.
I don't actually know it all that well. But he's on a version of it. Billy Ray came on to legitimize this as like, this is country music. Uh-huh. Look, I'm Billy Ray. I'm country.
Right.
So now this Lil Nas X song is country.
Oh, yeah.
So that's why he came on. And now we're seeing it with Beyonce.
Right.
Of people who are saying like, oh, someone from Texas doesn't know country music.
Yeah.
Only Australians know country music.
Yeah, when she's like from Texas and she has...
I think she's from Dallas or Houston.
Houston. But she like in another album that she released, she talks about like being from Texas and how Texas her life is and everything.
Yeah.
It's like if it sounded a little bit different, it would have just been country music.
Yeah.
Because it was like more of a hip hop album. So it was different. But yeah, that's really interesting that everyone's up in arms because she can't release a country album.
Yeah.
That's not allowed.
And full disclosure, I will defend her and say that, yes, that is country music. Mm-hmm. I will also say, it's not good. I don't like it. I don't think it's a good album.
I mean, but like...
I feel like people are either on one side or the other. They're either like, I hate it. She can't do that. Or everything she does is gold. And yeah. I'm more like, do everything you want. That is country.
Uh-huh.
And I don't care for it. So I make both sides angry.
I'm happy when people are doing new things.
Just do something.
Try a new thing. It's cool. And like when you're that famous and you're known for something, like, yeah, I understand wanting to branch out after being known for like a specific thing forever. That's cool. That's how artistry works.
Yeah, that is evolution.
Yeah.
That is good. That's how new music is made. And anyone can make country music. But mm-hmm. that is not what the Country Music Association thought. So there was a bunch of criticism because they were using those horns,
right.
which the Country Music Association dubbed as
Mexican. So he made a Mexican music.
So they're like, we don't like that.
Oh.
Yeah. So that was that started making people angry. But let's take a look at him playing Ring of Fire.
Excellent.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring, bound by wild desire. I fell into a ring of fire. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire.
That's classic. Classic Johnny Cash.
There's also a video somewhere of me with my grade 4 class in Korea, and I taught them that song, and
aww.
We all played that together.
That's fun.
Because it's a simple song for learning the English language.
Yeah. It's got a good slow rhythm to it and clear words.
Well, let's jump from that ring of fire to a forest of fire.
Whoa.
Because in 1965, Johnny's camper caught fire during a fishing trip in Los Padres National Forest in California, and it triggered a forest fire that burned several hundred acres and nearly caused his death.
Oh.
And it was thought that he was all drugged out, because he was drugged out a lot in those days, and he started a fire to stay warm, and it got out of control. So it destroyed 508 acres of national park, and also drove off 49 of the refuge's 53 endangered California condors.
Oh my goodness.
And Johnny was pretty unrepentant, and he was quoted as saying, "I don't care about your damn yellow buzzards."
Okay.
And he eventually settled the case and had to pay $82,000, and still holds the record for the only person to ever be sued by the U.S. government for starting a fire.
Wow.
So there's a little claim to fame. And I bet you're wondering at this point, like, hey, I thought you said Johnny Cash was a good guy. He sounds like a real asshole. Yes. Two things can be true. Yes. And we'll get to the good parts later.
Okay.
So let's go a little more with the asshole stuff. Because he has this kind of image of the romantic outlaw, right? Mm-hmm. And he's always singing about prisons, but he never once served a prison sentence, but did land in jail 7 times for misdemeanors, and he would usually only stay like one night each time. So in May of 1965, he was arrested in Mississippi for trespassing late at night. And while on tour that same year in El Paso, he was arrested by the narcotics squad.
Oh.
And the officers suspected he was smuggling heroin from Mexico. That's what they thought. And so they looked through his stuff and they're like, oh, he's not smuggling heroin from Mexico. He is smuggling dexedrine capsules, which is an amphetamine.
Right.
And he had 688 dexedrine capsules.
That's
and 475 Equinols, which is like a tranquilizer type thing. Because you got to even it
you
out
gotta
the
come
amphetamines.
You got to come down off of the amphetamines, yeah.
So that was hidden in his guitar case.
Oh.
So no heroin, but a lot of other stuff. He began performing concerts at prisons in the late 50s. So he played at San Quentin State Prison in 1958, and that would lead to him doing a pair of live albums from prison. Johnny Cash at Folsom Prison in 1968, and Johnny Cash live at San Quentin in 1969. So let's watch a video, and if you get a chance to look at this video, a lot of these ones are great, but I like this one a lot because this is him performing the song San Quentin at San Quentin.
Oh, very cool.
So he's going, he's pandering to his audience,
yeah.
And
oh,
they're
yeah.
gonna love it, and they do, and it's fun to see the reaction with this audience.
Oh.
San Quentin, you've been living hell to me. You blistered me since 1963. I've seen them come and go, and I've seen them die. And long ago I stopped asking why. San Quentin, I hate every inch of you. You cut me and you scarred me through and through. And I'll walk out a wiser, weaker man. Mr. Congressman, you can't understand.
Like, I think we think of those songs as like, yeah, he's singing about prisons. He's like a cool
yeah.
guy. He's an outlaw. But when you listen to it also, he's saying that prison is not effective.
Right.
He's like, what good do you think you do? And he's saying, like, congressman, you'll never understand. And that was something that he was passionate about for his entire life was prison reform. He said
right.
that our prison system does no good. It only breeds criminals, right?
Right.
It makes people angry, it breaks them down, and that's why there's such high recidivism rates. And mm-hmm. recidivism, my top 5 favorite words. It's a good one. Try it with me.
Recidivism.
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 Yeah, good word. That and synesthesia are my favorites.
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah, it's interesting to see him like a little bit older now and like more sure of what he's doing.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's a pretty confident performer
yeah.
and would continue to be. But along with his activism for prisoners, another group that he felt was marginalized and would speak on the behalf of were Indigenous Americans.
Oh.
Because throughout the mid-60s, he started releasing a number of concept albums, one of which was called His Bitter Tears in 1964. And this was a spoken word album devoted to songs addressing the plight of Indigenous Americans and the, particularly their mistreatment by the American government. Mm. And while this did initially reach the country charts, again, there was a lot of resistance from some fans, but mostly country music associations and radio stations because of his opinion, not right. because of the content musically, but because of the content of what he was saying. Because singing songs of Indian tragedy, as he called it, and settler violence was radically against what mainstream country music was doing at this point in the 50s and 60s, because this was a time where it was the idea of this righteous cowboy. Mm-hmm. Like when we think of a cowboy, it's this white guy who's coming into town and he's killing everyone.
Yeah.
Also, if you look into it, most cowboys are black.
Oh.
Because they were laborers, right? It was a transition from slavery into cowboys, yeah. what often happened. But that's not what we get to see. Anyways, the album's single, The Ballad of Ira Hayes, in case anyone doesn't know who Ira Hayes was, you know that statue and photo of soldiers lifting the flag on Iwo Jima? It's everyone like leaning together and there's yeah. the flag getting lifted up. One of those men was a man named Ira Hayes. And Ira Hayes was an American soldier. He was an Indigenous American from the, oh man, which tribe? Pima tribe? I'm not exactly sure. So you guys can do some research mm-hmm. on that. And Ira had is a really sad story because he is this literal icon of what America stands for. Mm-hmm. And in so many ways, because then he comes back to his reservation. He lives on a reservation mm-hmm. and there's no clean drinking water. He lives a life that is dominated largely by alcoholism, and he ends up dying very literally drunk in a ditch. He drowned in a puddle.
Oh.
And it's like, it doesn't get more on the nose of the image of America of like, look at this thing, we are conquering, we are soldiers, but also this is how those people are treated.
Mm-hmm.
He is both sides of that. And Johnny wrote the song called The Ballad of Ira Hayes, and there was a lot of resistance, and the editor of Country Music Magazine urged him to leave the Country Music Association. They said Johnny Cash is not welcome here anymore because of his stance on this sort of stuff. So in a reaction in 1964, he posted this kind of open letter and on a billboard, because that's how he could get it out there. And he called the record industry cowardly, and one part of it, he says, DJs, station managers, owners, where are your guts? And then it continues, he says, I had to fight back when I realized that so many stations are afraid of Ira Hayes. One question, why? And then he goes on to say, Ira Hayes is strong medicine. So is Rochester, Harlem, Birmingham, and Vietnam. And those other towns were, of course, towns of different social movements, whether it's a civil rights largely for Black Americans, or what was happening in different parts of the anti-war movements mm-hmm. as well. He is this like good old boy. That's what we think of Johnny Cash, right?
Yeah.
We don't think of him as like, oh yeah, he protested Vietnam.
Right.
Like, he was on the side of the hippies.
Right.
We kind of have this dichotomy now of country music is right wing. It is conservative.
Yeah.
But when people say outlaw country, that's what it meant. Like, Willie Nelson is a hippie, right? Mm-hmm. He's Johnny Cash is a like a true love everybody type of Christian.
Yeah.
He practiced what he preached.
Right.
I guess.
Oh, that's nice.
And he would shine a light on racial discrimination wherever he saw it. And later on, he would go on to have his own show, the Johnny Cash Show, and he would continue telling stories of Native American plight, both in song, and sometimes they would just do short films about like life on the reservations to show people what it was like,
right.
because he felt a kindred spirit in all of people that he felt were marginalized and forgotten by a lot of society, whether that was prisoners, Indigenous Americans, Vietnam War veterans, a lot of people that he felt America was turning its back on, and he thought that he has this voice and he's going to use mm-hmm. it for them. So let's take a look at him playing The Ballad of Ira Hayes on a reservation.
Okay.
So you get to see the reaction from the audience, and I think it's a very powerful one.
There they battled up Iwo Jima's hill, 250 men, but only 27 lived to fight back down again.
And when that fight was over, and when Old Glory raised, among the men to hold it high was the Indian, Ira Hayes. Call him drunken Ira Hayes, he won't answer anymore. Not the whiskey-drinking Indian nor the Marine that went to war. Ira Hayes returned the hero, celebrated through the land. He was wined and speeched and honored. Everybody shook his hand. But he was just a Pima Indian. No water, no crops, no chance. At home, nobody cared what Ira done. And when did the Indians dance? And then Ira started drinking hard. Jail was often his home. There they'd let him raise a flag and lower it like you'd throw a dog a bone. He died drunk early one morning, alone in a land he fought to save. 2 inches of water in a lonely ditch was a grave for Ira Hayes.
It's not one of his maybe best known songs, but I always like to include that one because it is a powerful one.
Yeah, it's sad.
It is.
Very sad.
Very sad. And he doesn't sugarcoat it or anything, right?
It's, no, but yeah.
This is what happened.
That's a... It's an important song, I think.
Yeah. So he's continuing being very successful, but also his drug addiction and his kind of self-destructive behavior is getting worse. He starts having performances canceled, but he's getting by. He's being successful, and he's becoming more and more dependent on alcohol and drugs. And this is the time where finally he gets divorced from Vivian Liberto. She files for divorce. Because of his drug and alcohol abuse, the constant touring, and affairs with other women. And particularly, she makes note of his relationship with June Carter.
Right.
So it's funny, like, through all the stuff we were talking about, he had a wife and 4 children at home during
all
of
this. I know, that's crazy.
Yeah, I don't think he was around too
much. Didn't really like her that much.
So he was arrested again in 1967, this time in Georgia, and... Police again found a bunch of prescription pills that he did not have a prescription for when he was in a car accident, probably driving under the influence. And he attempted to bribe the deputy who turned him down and sent him to jail. And it was there that there was a sheriff named Ralph Jones who essentially just like gave him a talking to.
Oh.
And you're like, because he's famous, he gets off with a talking to. But it kind of worked.
Oh.
Like, he gave him a long talk, and he warned him about the danger of his behavior, about his wasted potential. And he credited that moment as one of the real pivotal moments of his life, and he does kind of turn things around.
Oh, that's good.
And another big part of what turned his life around was now that he was divorced, he was now able to more openly pursue June, and... Or perhaps now she was able to reciprocate a little bit.
Right.
Because in 1967, the next year, he does a duet with June Jackson, which wins a Grammy. And at this point, June, Maybelle, and Ezra Carter moved into Johnny's house for a month and force him off of drugs.
Right.
He asks for the help, and they give him the hard love that he needs.
Good.
So... he was clean for that month, and that's what really helped him kind of like, I've never dealt with addiction, so I don't really know, but from the way it's described is like he needed to get to a certain point, and then it kind of is easier from there.
Right.
But he needed that help, and they were the ones to give it to him. And he would propose to June just the next year in February of 1968. In London, Ontario, in a concert there.
Oh.
He proposed to her on stage, and they were married just a week later in Kentucky. And she agreed to marry him after he had cleaned up his act. And they would go on to have one child together. That's John Carter Cash, which is probably the namesake of Noah Wiley in ER, I would say.
Oh.
Maybe not.
John Carter.
And Carter and Cash would go on to continue to work together, to make music together, to raise their child together, to tour for 35 years.
That's
right
crazy.
Until June's death in May of 2003.
Oh, wow.
And throughout their marriage, June attempted to keep Johnny off drugs, often taking his drugs away from him, flushing them down the toilet when she needed to. And she remained with him through multiple admissions to rehab treatment centers, and he would relapse. He would go on to relapse right. over the years. But he was, I would say, mostly clean. We'll talk a little bit about those relapses. But without her, yeah, he wouldn't be. She was more than a wife. She was like his caretaker in a lot of ways, too.
Wow, that's really interesting.
So let's take a look at their, I think, their most famous duet in Jackson. And if you watch the video of it, it's a great video because he looks like he's having so much fun.
When I breathe into that city, people gonna stoop and bow. All them women gonna make me teach them what they don't know how. I'm going to Jackson. You turn loose of my coat, my long-tailed coat. Yeah, I'm going to Jackson.
That's all she wrote.
Oh, get them in.
Like they're having so much fun.
Yeah, and they're like joking around up there and everything, and like she always looks so shocked when he sings his lines.
Yeah,
and like it's just play like acting, a cute little dynamic that they have going on up there.
They look happy.
Yeah,
that's nice to see. So you said, what's his nickname?
The Man in Black.
The Man in Black. So we're going into the early 70s now, and he's kind of cultivated that image as the Man in Black. And he would regularly perform dressed in all black, often with a long black, like knee-length coat. Mm-hmm. And it was in contrast to a lot of country stars of the time, because this was the time of rhinestone suits,
right.
of cowboy
tassels
boots. Of,
and,
yeah. And in 1971, he wrote a song called The Man in Black that explains why he wears what he does. And rather than tell you, we're just going to listen to the song.
Okay.
And us here, we are going to watch the video. And if you get a chance to watch the video, it's a really interesting one because we're going back a little ways in how he's performing it, because he doesn't look nearly as confident as some
right.
of the other ones, because this video that I have here is the first time he ever performed it.
Oh yeah, then you'd be nervous.
Yeah. He had just finished writing it like 3 hours earlier.
Oh.
And just really wanted to get this message out there. So you could actually see him reading off of cue cards, because he had just finished writing the song. So he's reading it and it doesn't seem as confident as perhaps some other ones. But there's some really interesting cuts to the audience here. And we have an idea of what country music fans look and act like.
Yeah.
Probably stereotypical and probably partially unfair.
Yes.
And this shows who his audience actually was. And it's, if you don't watch the video, it's a lot of people that we would now call hippies.
Right.
Right? That's who a lot of his audience was at the time, because he is a very progressive-minded person.
Huh.
And it really comes out in this song. So let's watch and listen to The Man in Black.
I wear it for the sick and lonely old, for the reckless ones whose bad trip left them cold. I wear the black in mourning for the lives that could have been. Each week we lose 100 fine young men. And yes, I wear it for the thousands who have died, believing that the Lord was on their side. And I wear it for another 100,000 who have died, believing that we all were on their side. Well, there's things that never will be right, I know. And things need changing everywhere you go. But till we start to make a move to make a few things right, you'll never see me wear a suit of white. I'd love to wear a rainbow every day to tell the world that everything's okay. But maybe I can carry off a little darkness on my back till things are brighter
I'm the man in black.
That's a powerful one, too. I like
that. Yeah, I've never really considered that some of his music is like almost like protest music.
Absolutely.
But it is. It totally is.
That's what outlaw country used to mean, right? And he's grouping all these people together, like anyone who's disenfranchised, but he's also saying people who overdosed on drugs, like I do this for you. Yeah. People who were in prisons, I do this for you. If you were dying in wars, and he's...
Yeah.
Saying that, like, I would love to wear a rainbow every day, mm-hmm. but he lives in a state of mourning because nobody is mourning these people. Right. So he's taking it upon himself. And I like that a lot.
Yeah, that's like, it's a heavy one, but I think it's an important one.
It's so much better than just thinking of him as like, oh yeah, he wears blacks, it's cool.
Right.
Right? He has something behind all of that. He also had relationships with pretty much every president who... Sat in his time. You sit in office?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess you're just sitting in that
president.
Office.
Yeah. You're a sitting president, yeah.
So he was closest to Jimmy Carter. And Jimmy Carter, he's kind of one of those like nice guy mm-hmm. presidents. A lot of people really hate him, though.
One of those nice guy presidents, yeah.
That's not a
thing.
Yeah, an assumption anymore that a president's nice.
Yeah.
Most of them are assholes. I'd say most.
Yeah.
Most are assholes. And he was good friends with Jimmy Carter because Jimmy was actually distant cousin to June.
Oh.
And he met Richard Nixon in 1972. And while in that meeting, he advocated for prison reform. That was his main reason. Mm-hmm. Nixon's main reason was like, hey, come play some music for me. And Nixon asked him to play three songs. He asked him to play Okie from Muskogee, which mm-hmm. is not a Johnny Cash song, but it is a, but like, you know, he would just, Johnny Cash would play whatever song.
Yeah, it's a country music song, yeah.
It's a song about like hating drug users and war protesters.
Oh.
He asked him to play Welfare Cadillac, mm-hmm. which is a song about how people use and abuse welfare. Like mm-hmm. they don't really need it. They're using it to buy a Cadillac.
Right.
And A Boy Named Sue.
Right.
So he did play A Boy Named Sue, mm-hmm. but he refused to play the other two because he said that he will not play music that is anti-hippie and anti-black. And that's what he felt that those two were. Instead, he played The Ballad of Ira Hayes, mm-hmm. which we talked about, and The Man in Black.
Oh.
So he used his opportunity to take it right to the president.
That's very cool.
Yeah, I like that a lot because there's a lot of people who... Like when you win a sports championship, you get to go to meet the president oftentimes, and people will just say like, oh, I'm not going because that's my protest. I'd go and then just be a dick.
Like that's your moment. They're giving you a platform.
And he used it. So he sang those songs and then only wanted to talk about prison reform. So those are the things I mean when I say like, no, Johnny Cash was a good guy.
Good for him.
He has some more health issues as time goes on. We're now jumping up into 1983, and his health issues this time, maybe not what you'd expect. He almost dies because he was kicked by an ostrich.
What?
Yeah. I think he had an ostrich farm, or he was on an ostrich farm. Either way, ostriches are dangerous.
Yeah.
They kick you, they'll cut your belly right open. Wow. So one kicked him, and it cut his belly right open.
Gross.
Yeah. So, his belly gets cut open. They do save him. He goes to the hospital, gets put on painkillers, but becomes addicted to those painkillers now. But again, with the help of June, and now that he's like just better at it, he's not as much of a piece of shit anymore, he does kick it again. Then in 1988, he goes to see Waylon Jennings, who is in the hospital because he was recovering from a heart attack. Mm-hmm. And Waylon says like, hey, man, like, me and you have lived similar lives. We were not kind to ourselves with all the drugs we were doing. You should get yourself checked out. And he's like, okay, yeah, I'll go check. I'll take you up on that. Talks to a doctor right there, and they're like, you need surgery now. So had he not checked on Waylon Jennings, he might have just died.
Right.
Because he was put into, he got surgery, double bypass that same day. And then... when he was in recovery, and in recovery with Waylon, so he gets to be there with
his
buddy.
That's nice.
He would not take any painkillers because he's like, no, I know me, and I'm going to get hooked on them again. So he recovers without painkillers.
Wow. That's impressive. Having had major surgery, it's not something you want to do without painkillers. Mm-hmm.
So he is less popular as the years go on, and he's actually dropped by Columbia Records. They don't want him anymore.
Oh.
So he does a short stint with Mercury from 87 to 91, and he's just not sought out by major labels. Instead, he signs a contract with Rick Rubin's American Recordings. And you might not know Rick Rubin, no. But to me, he's the guy that produced a bunch of really good Ghetto Boys music.
Oh, okay.
So he did Ghetto Boys. He did a lot of like Public Enemy stuff. He was a co-founder with Chuck D of Def Jam Records.
Oh.
So a very different kind of music.
Right.
It's not Columbia. It's not Sun. But Rick Rubin didn't just do hip-hop. He also did a lot of metal. Like, he did Slayer, he did Metallica.
Huh.
So, different music, for yeah. sure. So, he signs on with this American Recordings label, and it's an odd move. And this was, like, a huge revitalization to Johnny Cash's mm-hmm. career. And it's kind of when I became familiar with Johnny Cash. Because some of these American Recordings are some of my favorite albums ever made. I think they're just fantastic. So he brings this very different sound to it. It's not what you'd consider traditional country. Actually, you know what? It is very traditional country.
Right.
But not like 60s country. Going back further, because it gets really sparse, really stripped down. And almost all of the songs are just Johnny and a guitar.
Right.
Some of them, they started out just recording in his living room. Because mm-hmm. they're not... It's not going to be polished. It's not going to be glitzy in any way. It's just like, it's folk music, like mm-hmm. proper folk country music. And he releases a few albums like this. I think it was in 94 the first one came out. And he wins the Grammy for Best Contemporary Folk Album. And then he goes and does Glastonbury in 94.
Oh.
And it's Johnny Cash who is... At this, like a couple years earlier, maybe you'd think of as like a washed up country star.
Uh-huh.
And now he's becoming this, once again, like a countercultural icon.
Right.
And he's playing Glastonbury, and he says it's one of the highlights of his career because he's getting this huge reception of this whole new audience who's uh-huh. finding his music again. And then much like I did, probably they're going back and seeing his old stuff. And then you're like, oh, this dude was hardcore the whole time.
Yeah.
This guy was always great. But the stuff he does at this point is much more in line with the music that I like. Mm-hmm. So I love these ones. In 96, he does American Recordings 2, which wins the Best Country Album Grammy. And he does a total of 7 of these, just called American Recordings, numbers 1 through 7.
Oh.
And the last one comes out after his death.
Right.
I think all of them just great. There's even this box set called Unearthed, which is... kind of the things that were cut off of these. Those ones are really good. But the most popular one probably was his cover of Hurt. And I think you've probably heard this one, even if you don't recognize it right now. When we play it, you'll be like, oh yeah, that one. So these songs, most of them are covers.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll be covers of sometimes classic folk songs or old standards, and a lot of the times contemporary pop or metal, all sorts of things that you wouldn't traditionally expect Johnny Cash to mm-hmm. be playing. Hurt is a Nine Inch Nails song.
Oh.
And it sounds very different. Trent Reznor, I think, has even said that Hurt is no longer his song. He said, no, Johnny, it's a Johnny Cash song now. Like, I know that I wrote it and made it first, but after what Johnny did, that's his song now.
Right.
So let's listen to that one. My favorite is probably his cover of Danzig's 13. So go check that one out. But I'm not going to play that. I'm going to play the big hit. So we're going to listen to Hurt, and we will watch the video. The video also so sad because the song is about a man kind of sharing his regrets over mm-hmm. his life. And then you have these images of Johnny over his life and June. She's there and it's haunting. It's a very haunting song. So let's take a look and listen to that.
I wear this crown of thorns upon my liar's chair. Full of broken thoughts, I cannot repair. Beneath the stains of time, the feelings disappear. you are someone else. I am still right here. What have I become? My sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you hurt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I would keep myself. I would find a way.
I think there's like three times in this little thing we've done that I get chills from a few of these songs.
That was like
Ira
crazy.
Hayes and Men in Black and this one. Yeah. It's powerful stuff to me,
it
at
is.
Least. Yeah.
No, I agree. I think that was very powerful with all of the video of his life too. It's very powerful imagery. And his voice is so powerful.
I love how his voice aged. Yeah. I maybe prefer elderly Johnny Cash to the young one.
Yeah.
I think that's just a sound that I like. The more sparse guitar with this gravelly, deep voice to it.
Yeah, great. It's pretty great, yeah.
So that's kind of bringing us close to the end of this. So let's go into the final years of Johnny Cash. In 1997, he was diagnosed with autonomic neuropathy associated with diabetes, and this forced him to end his touring. He was hospitalized in 98 with pneumonia, which had damaged his lungs pretty extensively. But that's not what kills him. I think what it really is June dies on May 15th of 2003 at the age of 71. And before dying, she tells him, keep working. And through his life, it kind of seemed like he had just a few things that he always had.
Mm-hmm.
He had drugs and alcohol, which he was on and off with, eventually gave him up, and at this point had been clean for quite some time. He was a very religious man. Mm-hmm. Once he met June, he had her and he had his music. So now he doesn't have the drugs anymore. He doesn't have June anymore. So he throws himself into his music because he would die just 4 months after her.
Aww.
And in those 4 months, he records 60 more songs and even performed a couple of surprise shows at the Carter Family Fold in Bristol, Virginia. And on July 5th of 2003 was his last public performance. He would go on to die from complications from diabetes on September 12th of 2003 at the age of 71 as well, less than 4 months after June had died, because it's a thing that happens pretty often. And for someone who was so dependent on someone, she quite literally saved his life.
Right.
Multiple times.
Took care of him.
And
sure that
when
he was...
she wasn't there, he didn't have much to keep him going. Made a lot of music in those 4 months, but he did pass away then. And a lot of people just attribute it to a broken heart over the death of June. He was buried next to June in Hendersonville Memory Gardens near their home in Tennessee. And there would be a couple of albums that would come out after his death from that American Recordings series. And a lot of great music on there. I wish I could play so much more of it, but go listen to it. It's all really good. So I guess we can talk a little bit about the legacy of Johnny Cash. In 2005, Walk the Line with Joaquin Phoenix and Reese Witherspoon came out and was a considerable commercial success and critical as well.
I
think it was very good.
I liked it because it also had a really good soundtrack with it. So.
Yeah. Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash. But yeah, I really liked it.
And I think Phoenix was nominated for an Oscar and I think Witherspoon won.
I think so.
Roseanne Cash went on to have a very good career herself. Same with John Carter Cash. In 2015, a new species of black tarantula was identified near Folsom Prison, and they named it Aphanopelma Johnny Cashi in his honor, because it was all black. The Johnny Cash Museum opened in 2013 in Nashville. Ring of Fire was that kind of one of those like jukebox musical touring shows, came here not too long ago. That started going. He had appeared on a few different TV shows, quite a few, Dr. Quinn and Columbo. But many people of my age will know him best as the mystical coyote from The Simpsons. He won 9 Country Music Awards and 18 Grammys.
Wow.
Interesting that a country music star would have more Grammys than Country Music Awards. But it kind of shows he wasn't as beloved by them as he was by others. He's on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. He has a Lifetime Achievement Grammy. Rolling Stone ranked him number 31 on the 100 Greatest Artists of All Time. He's in the Country Music Hall of Fame, the Rock and Roll Music Hall of Fame, and the Gospel Music Hall of Fame, because he does a lot of gospel music. There's one album in particular called My Mother's Hymn Book that I liked a lot. That's a really good one. And I think over all of those awards and things, I think what he contributed most is he epitomized outlaw country and like outlaw country, what it really should be, which is challenging the status quo and using your music for social justice, because now somehow social justice has become like a bad thing.
Yeah.
Like, oh, they're a social justice warrior. Like, so do you hate justice?
Yeah.
I don't understand why that's a bad thing. Yeah. So you know who's a social justice warrior? Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash.
So Johnny Cash, I was going to say another sentence here, but I don't have one. That's it. We're done.
Johnny Cash, period.
So go listen to some Johnny Cash. this one is funny because we're going to release the Bob Marley one next week, a rebroadcast of that. Johnny Cash is the music I will play if I'm in the car with my dad, because that's the only music that we both like, because he grew up on Johnny Cash, was a very big fan. And my mom likes Bob Marley, so that's what I'll play if I'm in the car with her.
Aww.
So these are the two things that that we're going to put out. So that's it for Johnny Cash. Go listen to his music. And join us again next week when you can learn all about Bob Marley. Another very interesting story.
We'll see you in 2 weeks for sure, where we reveal next month's theme.
Yeah, and until then, listen to some Bob Marley next week.
Okay, bye everyone.
Goodbye. I would love to be a Muppet Baby.
Which Muppet Baby would you be?
Oh, well, I would like to be other ones, but I'm a Kermie. I'm generally good, but a little neurotic and worried.
Yeah, I could see that.
That's who I am. I would love to be a Fozzie or a Ralph or a carefree animal or the star of the show in Piggy, but I'm not. I'm a Kermie.
Who am I?
You're a Piggy, probably.
Oh, okay.
You're the charismatic star.
Yeah.
You're That's like, me. Hey, baby, I'm here.
That is me. I often enter rooms like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I have some Fozzie tendencies, but...
No, what's Fozzie like?
He's the wisecracker.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
He's like a...
full of jokes.
So Muppet Babies is already a dated reference, right. But Fozzie was like a vaudeville kind of guy.
Oh.
Which is more dated. But now we're talking about Muppet Babies, and that's not what this podcast's about. But maybe it should be. Yeah. Look for our Muppet Babies episode That'd coming out great. Soon.